Hey guys, Pasty here. Now, December has finally arrived after a very long year. Turkeys, you know, Thanksgiving's finally done. There's a lot of important things in December. Christmas, pretty big one, you probably heard of it. New Year's is pretty cool, I guess, but arguably the most important one is actually... That's right, baby, it's Star Wars season. All that shit I just said a second ago, toss it out the window. Turkeys, dry as fuck. Santa, can get the fuck out of my chimney, alright? I want Darth Vader instead. I don't want stockings, okay? I want spaceships. I don't want to see little lightning bulbs and ornaments, okay? I want fucking Death Stars, alright? That's right, all Death Stars. All fucking 19 of them throughout the entire franchise, okay? Just feed them to me in my mouth, baby.
Oh, delicious.
Seriously, though, every winter, I get this feeling, this Star Wars vibe around me the whole time. I mean, it's probably because, you know, Disney released the sequel trilogy in December, as well as, you know, Mandalorian starts in November and goes through December. But, nevertheless, I feel like talking about Star Wars. The question is, where do I start? You know, what do I talk about? There's so much subject matter when it comes to Star Wars. I mean, do I talk about the downfall of the sequel trilogy, or, you know, what's the worst Star Wars movie, what's the best Star Wars movie? But, when I got thinking to it, I just decided, fuck it, why don't I just start from the beginning, with a little movie from 1977 called... For the longest time, I thought that A New Hope was just like the lamer or, I guess, more boring version of Empire. Like, I knew it was great, I loved it, but it didn't really hold a candle to Empire. I mean, none of them did. But that was until I kind of had an epiphany. You see, recently I rewatched A New Hope after not, you know, seeing it for probably a couple years. And I don't know what was going through my head. You know, I loved it, but I just, like, it's almost like my mind matured somehow. Like, I thought I was in that state already, but clearly I didn't appreciate this movie enough. And after rewatching it, god damn, it's almost perfect, even with its flaws. Like, I'll get into it, but god damn. And, of course, I'm talking about the theatrical release, not the fucking massacre that is the special editions. Now, let's rewind a bit, alright? The year is 1977. You're going to the movies to see this weird thing called space battles or something like that. And, you know, you're going to the theater, a normal experience, you know, you get your popcorn, you get your snacks, you get all that. And then all of a sudden, you're hit with fucking... Alright, that's the last time I'm gonna jump scare you with that. But, seriously, I do think that having an opening title crawl is absolutely genius. I mean, if you go to the theater and you see this nowadays or something, you might think, what the fuck am I looking at? Just words going up my screen telling me stuff? Like, yeah, you'd think it's weird. But back then, I mean, Star Wars was not a thing. The closest thing they had was 2001 Space Odyssey, and let me tell you, It's not what Star Wars is. It was just in space. It had the spectacle, but the thing about Star Wars is that it's super fucking weird. Having something like this, just kind of an intro for the audience to get a grasp on the world, even a little bit, is just absolutely genius. Plus, you know, the yellow text with the space going back at the slant is just very, I mean, it's pleasing to me. And then the music is just fucking beautiful. And then once you finish up the title crawl, the first thing you see is a little spaceship, you know, it's going through space, something's firing at it, it's firing at something, and then entering the scene, the giant Imperial Star Destroyer, really just showing how imposing and how intimidating the Empire is. I mean, this movie really makes it a point. It really hammers it in that the Empire means fucking business, right? They're not here to fuck around, okay? Like, and there's more scenes, you know, throughout the journey that you're about to go on that really emphasize this, but opening with this shot of the Empire just crushing the Rebellion is absolutely genius. It really just shows that the antagonist of this story does not fuck around. All right, so let's get into the real meat and potatoes of this thing. Let's fast forward a bit. By this point, Luke finds out about the message from Princess Leia, goes to Obi-Wan. Obi-Wan wants him to help him save the galaxy. Luke resists because of, you know, his Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru, so he's like, nah. And then it turns out that they get fucking torched. Oh, and a quick side note, I really like how whenever Luke figures out that Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru might be in trouble, that he rushes home to try and save them, and while he's, like, in his speeder going that way, you, like, hear the triumphant, like, hero music, kind of, like, crescendo, almost. And it's just, like, a nice, musical cue, I guess, that really shows, like, oh, Luke's ready to fucking take on this, like, threat to the galaxy. I just really like that little detail. Alright, so now our characters need to find a way off this planet. So they go to the local cantina in Mos Eisley and try and find someone who can help them get off the planet. And this is where we meet the best character in this movie by far.
Han Solo. I'm Captain of the Millennium Falcon.
Alright, so like I just said, Han Solo is the best character in this movie, and one of the big reasons I feel that way is his actual character intro. Han is on screen for like 5 minutes straight, I think, whenever we first meet him. And while that kind of seems like a lot, like, I feel like we get a good sense of who he is in those 5 minutes. In these 5 minutes or so, I feel like we get a lot of little moments that really show us who Han actually is. An example of what I'm trying to say is that when we first meet Han Solo, and during the whole bargaining phase with Luke and Obi-Wan, he seems like just a straight-up gunslinger who is just trying to hustle these guys into getting a better deal, and it seems like he's got his shit together. However, after successfully getting a better deal out of Obi-Wan and Luke, after they go start heading towards the Millennium Falcon, Han immediately turns to Chewie and starts celebrating, saying like, oh yeah, we really did it, like, thank God we got this deal out of them, we really swindled these guys out of their money. This moment just kind of goes to show, like, who Han actually is, along with the Greedo encounter that really just hammers home who Han Solo is and gives us an amazing intro to a character that we love, and I think it's a big part of at least why I love Han Solo, that's for sure. Alright, so by this point I've been talking for like 7 minutes about stuff that just happens in the movie and things I like along the way, but one of the things that I noticed on my most recent watch through that really make me appreciate this movie even more is that while all these things I'm talking about happen, we cut back and forth between scenes of like Darth Vader and Grand Moff Tarkin that really build upon not only the universe, it gives us more information about the world we're in right now, but also emphasizes the notion that the Empire is an actual threat to the galaxy. We get several scenes that show off the power of the Empire, the Death Star, and
the power of the Force.
I mean, we get a scene dedicated to Grand Moff Tarkin just being like, oh yeah, let's just blow up Alderaan. I mean, at this point, they don't even know that the Rebel base is on there. They only know that Leia said it's on Dantooine. And while Tarkin kind of deciphers, like, that's not a reliable choice, like, of course it's not on Dantooine, they don't know for sure that it is on Alderaan. As far as they're concerned, it is still a peaceful planet. So Grand Moff Tarkin just decides,
continue with the operation. You may fire when ready.
And so the main thing I wanted to talk about in this video, the main thing that made me go wow at this movie, is that while we're cutting back and forth between our heroes and villains, we're not only learning more about each side, but we're also getting a perfect flow of information about this world. The fact that you don't get sucked out of this movie and think to yourself, oh, this is super weird, I don't get it, all this, like, doesn't make sense, astonishes me. Even back then in 1977, they were never thinking, oh, this is whack. They were all in on the story, and that is due to the magnificent pacing and beautiful flow of information. Because Star Wars is whack, and the fact that you don't even question it is amazing and beautiful to me. Alright, so I kind of just want to finish off talking about some little details that I noticed along the way. I don't really have an excuse to talk about this. I kind of just want to do some more shilling about this movie. So we're just going to lightning round this one, baby. First up, I mentioned it earlier, but as Luke is rushing to go save Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru, the musical cue that kicks up, it turns into like a heroic brass kind of thing, and then obviously slowly simmers down to the more sad thing whenever you realize what happened. That musical cue is a nice little detail that I like. That's basically an example of what I'm going to be mentioning. Next up, Han kind of, I don't want to say he talks shit on Luke, because he doesn't, but there are a couple moments where he kind of tells Luke, like, listen, kid, it's not as easy as you think out there. One of them being this line.
Traveling through hyperspace ain't like dusting crops, boy.
And then a little detail of evidence towards the fact that Han knows what he's talking about, like, it's not as easy out here, is that during the Princess Leia rescue, every time Luke fires his blaster, he fucking closes both his eyes all the way shut. Like, every time. I was looking at it when I first noticed it. I was like, does he do it every time? And the answer is yes. He closes both of his eyes shut every time. And then lastly, I told you guys this was going to be a lightning round, but during the final ceremony sequence, I love how Han is quote-unquote wearing his nice outfit, but it's just the exact same thing as he's been wearing the whole time, except his undershirt isn't, like, unbuttoned and, like, you know, gunslingery. It's just a regular-ass t-shirt with a collar on it, and I love how that's what he considers, like, his nice outfit. Like, oh yeah, this is fit for ceremony, of course. Anyways, guys, I think that's gonna do it for this video. I really just want to talk about Star Wars because 'tis the season. Every December, like I said earlier, I just get a feeling of Star Wars. I just want to watch all the Star Wars movies and all that. But I hope you enjoyed. Go follow me on Twitter and Twitch. I'll have both those links in the description. But that's going to do it for this episode. I hope you enjoyed. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one. Deuces.